Hi guys, welcome back to the channel, FPL Consult here, and in today's video, I'm going to share with you guys my Game Week 7 team selection. I'll talk through how it looks like at the moment, but also a couple of transfers that I may make before the Game Week 7 deadline as well. So if you guys do enjoy this one, please do drop a like and also subscribe as well if you are new around here. So before we jump into Game Week 7, let's just conclude Game Week 6 because I've already done a run through of the points that I scored in the transfer plans video, but this time I've added the Semenyo points because the Bournemouth game has now ended, as well as the Rodgers points on the bench. So overall, after game week 6, my rank is 656k. So I think a very big red arrow, not the best game week again. And as with many game week 6 wildcarders, a lot of things didn't go our way. But what I would say is I've taken a step back now after the game week 6 games. I've looked at my players objectively and I've asked myself whether I think moving forward the team is still good to maximize the fixtures moving forward, and I still think that is the case. So I don't want to be too reactionary and, you know, make any changes drastically to the draft because I don't think that there's a need for it, and also because I think weeks like this happen once in a while where many things don't go your way. I still think looking at the team moving forward, it is in a good position. So I will be kind of, you know, making transfers to try and improve the team here and there, but I don't think any drastic changes need to be made. I'm pretty happy with them and we'll take a look at the Game Week 7 team later on. So in terms of the points that I've just added in, Semenyo thankfully got a goal. So he made the red arrow a little bit less red. And also, in terms of Rodgers, the bench points, I think there was a slight chance that I could have started Rodgers instead of Chris Wood, but I think that feels a bit hindsight as well because I think Chris Wood had the home fixture against Fulham, and as well, we knew that he was on penalty. So I think I still would have started Chris Wood, but yeah, having the bench points does not feel good, but it happens once in a while. So it is what it is. We can call it a day for Game Week 6 now, and let's have a look at Game Week 7. So having a look at the Game Week 7 clean sheet odds first before jumping into my team, this is a practice that I generally do every single game week to assess from a market perspective or a bookie's odds perspective of how the games are likely to turn out. So I think looking at the fixtures here, we see a couple of general things that, you know, you don't really need numbers to put to that, in which Arsenal and Man City have very high clean sheet odds, Southampton and Fulham respectively just have very low ones because, you know, these teams are expected to do very well. But I think a couple of teams that I want to highlight is firstly the Brighton and Spurs fixture all the way at the bottom there. I think Spurs are coming off a very good performance against Manchester United, and also you look at Brighton conceding a lot of goals against Chelsea, you would think maybe the Spurs versus Brighton game would see Spurs kind of running all over Brighton, but the bookies' odds here kind of tell that it's going to be a closer game than expected. It's 19% clean sheet odds for Brighton, and it's 18% clean sheet odds for Spurs. So I think it's going to be closer than expected. I don't think it's going to be a case where Spurs will run away with the game. And I do think, like, Brighton defensively just made so many mistakes against Chelsea that I'm so sure that Hertzler will do something about it in terms of maybe sharpening up the defense, changing a couple of personnel, bearing in mind that they also missed Van Heck in that game as well. So I think as well, if he comes back for the Spurs game, maybe we see a stronger Brighton defense, in which case it's less of a plump fixture for Spurs. Now, a couple of other teams that I want to highlight is the Aston Villa and the Manchester United game. So Aston Villa here with a 23% chance of a clean sheet and Manchester United with a 15% chance. So essentially, Aston Villa have the higher chance of scoring against United. But what I would say is also that Aston Villa have been quite leaky in defense, so United do have a decent chance of picking up a couple of returns there. And I also think that at this point, because Bruno Fernandes is now not suspended anymore, he is going to be fit and available. I mean, fit was never a question, but he's available because the suspension was removed. So now, because Bruno Fernandes, who is such an important player for Manchester United, will be back, I think that boosts their potential a little bit more in terms of getting a result at Aston Villa. But yeah, I mean, I don't think anyone would be going to buy Manchester United players now, especially how they performed in Game Week 6. But just something I thought I'd highlight. Aside from that, if you do want to kind of pause the video here and have a look at the odds in greater detail, feel free to do so. Let's have a look now at my Game Week 7 team. So this is my team for Game Week 7. I've not made any transfers so far. I have 0.1 million in the bank and I have one free transfer. So I think in terms of looking at the team overall, there are a couple of problem areas, and the intention was always to roll the transfer in game week 7 after having wild carded in game week 6. But now I think because of certain events, I am maybe open to making a transfer if I need to. So I will discuss them as we go along discussing the different areas of the team. So talking in goal first, I have Flacken against Wolves at home. I think that's a great fixture for him. And I also think that the clean sheet odds for Brentford is 35%. Looking at the graphic just now, it's a decent enough chance. Hopefully he comes away with something there. One point I want to make about the keepers is that I have Verbruggen on the bench, and it did not make for good watching in game week 6 that Brighton conceded 4 goals for sure. But again, I try to comfort myself by telling myself that it was because Van Heck wasn't there. But realistically speaking, there were a couple of other issues as well. So I do hope that moving forward, Hertzler will be able to strengthen the defence into what we saw in the earlier game weeks. In which case, come the time game week 12 comes around, I can be starting Verbruggen instead of Flacken. So that will be the rotation I'm going for, and it was the intention from the start. So hopefully Brighton do shore up the defence a little bit. In terms of the defenders that I have in the starting 11, it's Trent, Lewis, and Gabriel. So I think I'll speak about Trent first. He is in my team for game week 7, but I think very soon, could be as soon as game week 8, he will be leaving the team, because he is going to be the key to unlocking Cole Palmer for my team. I think Cole Palmer could be a player that I want. I'm just not so sure when I want to jump onto him. I don't think I'd do it now in game week 7, because that would mean it would be for a hit, something like Trent down to a cheap defender, and then Luis Diaz up to Cole Palmer. But I don't think it's necessary, because Liverpool have Crystal Palace away in game week 7, and I'm perfectly fine to keep the Liverpool assets for this game week 7 game. But from game week 8 onwards, the fixtures do start to get tricky for Liverpool, in which case I don't mind selling Trent. And because I want Cole Palmer down the line, I think a cheap defender for Trent is where I'm looking at, which also kind of locks out the option to go for Vardiol, which I did discuss in the transfer plans video, Trent to Vardiol being something I considered. But now, because I don't think that's something I want to do, I want to have extra money for Cole Palmer, then I think a cheap defender is where I'll look at for Trent. But for game week 7, I think it's fine. And just while we're on the topic of Cole Palmer as well, I think there are going to be a good number of people doing Saka to Cole Palmer in the next few weeks. What I would say to that is that I think looking at the fixtures moving forward, I do think a Haaland, Saka and Palmer draft is what everyone will be tending to from about game week 11 to game week 12 onwards. In which case, I'm thinking maybe I should just keep Saka throughout his kind of difficult run of fixtures from game week 9 to game week 11. And then I'd have him in my team already ready to go from game week 12 onwards. So I don't intend to make the Saka to Palmer move, which is also another reason why I need to drop Trent down to a cheap defender. Now, in terms of Man City defenders, we did speak about Vardiol just now, which I don't think I would get, you know, in the foreseeable future. And Lewis here against Fulham at home is definitely a risk. I don't think he is very likely to start. I think there's always risk involved with him, especially since he played 80 minutes in game week 6 and he also played 90 minutes in the Champions League. Got an assist, by the way, so he looks so good in Europe. I just hope he can, you know, deliver the same returns in the Premier League. For what it's worth, he's playing really well. But playing really well does not, you know, cut it when it comes to FPL. We need it to become returns. So I do hope we continue to, you know, see the good performances translate into returns for Rico Lewis. But that begins with a start. And for game week 7, I'm not going to lie, I think there is significant doubt because he's played quite a bit of minutes of late. So hopefully we get some leaks. The Man City game is the 3 p.m. kickoff. So hopefully we get some news from the Man City sources on Twitter. But he is a player that if he doesn't start, I think I may have to bench, and Greaves or Aina is going to come in. For the time being, it's more likely I start Greaves against West Ham away. So that's something I'm thinking about in terms of the Rico Lewis position. Gabriel, perfectly fine against Southampton, is one of the plump fixtures for him. In terms of midfielders, I have Mbeumo, Saka, Luis Diaz, Rodgers and Semenyo. Now, Mbeumo and Saka have, you know, perfectly fine fixtures, and they're such stable assets, I don't need to discuss much about these two. But I think Luis Diaz here is the main player I want to speak about. Now, I did say that I want to go for Cole Palmer, and it's mainly this Luis Diaz spot that I think Cole Palmer is going to come into. The only thing I'd ask myself right now is if I make one transfer, would I rather go for Brennan Johnson, who is someone I'm very keen on as well? And then, because I've made that Brennan Johnson transfer in Game Week 7 now, for example, I go for Cole Palmer later down the line after his difficult run of fixtures. So essentially, I have Brennan Johnson for the next maybe 3 to 4 game weeks and then swap him out for Cole Palmer down the line. The funds work out. I've had a look at that as well. And I think it's a decent consideration. I also think, you know, this could be, you know, me not having enough, you know, money for the Cole Palmer move, enough transfers as well, that I say this. But I think Brennan Johnson could do quite well looking at the way he's playing in the next few games. I don't think I'm going to confidently say that Brennan Johnson is going to outperform Palmer, but I do think like there is value in going for him. So because of that, and I can afford it in one transfer, I think Luis Diaz to Brennan Johnson is the main move I'm going to do if Luis Diaz, or if we get news that Luis Diaz is going to miss out, for example, or if the minutes he gets midweek, because I'm recording this before the Liverpool game, if the minutes he gets midweek is very high, say, you know, 70 to 80 minutes, I would be quite concerned about game week 7 for him against Crystal Palace, in which case I could be pushed to making the Brennan Johnson move. So that's the thinking behind this Luis Diaz position, which eventually, even if it becomes Johnson, will become Cole Palmer come game week 11 and game week 12. So that's just the thinking behind this spot. Rodgers and Semenyo, I don't intend to sell them at all. I actually think the Rodgers and Semenyo rotation works very, very well all the way up till the next wild card. And I think Semenyo just looks so sharp. Same with Rodgers as well. They're very good for minutes. The only concern with Rodgers was that there was some tightness in his hamstring. But midweek photos as well as reports say that he's fine, he's in training. And of course, Aston Villa will be involved in the Champions League, so hopefully he doesn't play too much there so that he'd be fine for the Manchester United game here in Game Week 7. If not, I think both of them are perfectly fine for Game Week 7, and I hope they do return. Up front, it's Havertz and Haaland. I won't speak so much about Haaland because I think he's going to be a massive captaincy shout as well, and we'll talk about captaincy in the next section, but I'm happy to have him here. And from Game Week 7 onwards, I think he's going to be a very big captaincy shout. For Havertz here, I think he will be quite a good differential, and it was mainly the reason I wanted to go for him instead of a second Arsenal defender, because I think the Game Week 6 games and the Game Week 7 games specifically are there to be had for Havertz to score. And maybe Game Week 8 is slightly tougher for Bournemouth away, but this Game Week 7 game against Southampton, looking at the way they still want to play out from the back, the way they play against Bournemouth was just abysmal. And I think Havertz, he's already scored a goal last week against Leicester. By all means, it was slightly lucky, but he did have good chances in that game to even score more points. So overall, maybe the returns evened out in Game Week 6. But in Game Week 7 against Southampton, I'm fully expecting to get something, especially coming off a goal in the Champions League against Paris Saint-Germain as well. So Havertz here, he is also a player that is not going to stay in my team for very long. He should become Solanke sooner rather than later. But now in Game Week 7 against Southampton is the plum fixture for him. And on the bench, I have Wood, Greaves, and Aina. So for Chris Wood, he's the only player I really want to mention here on the bench and spend a bit more time on. Would you start Chris Wood ahead of Rodgers against Manchester United? It's the only consideration I'm thinking about now. And I also do think, like, if Rodgers gets quite a bit of minutes in the Champions League, that they may just kind of want to manage his minutes a little bit, and maybe he doesn't get 90 minutes against Manchester United. And also, considering that Manchester United conceded so many goals against Spurs, maybe Ten Hag tries to shore up the defense, do something about it. Not that it would affect that much of a change, I imagine. But could I go for Chris Wood instead, who seems to be on penalties against Chelsea away, who are vulnerable in some respects as well? So the Rodgers and Wood situation for my team is something I'm thinking about. Who should I start? Who should I bench? Let me know down in the comments below what you're thinking with regards to this benching decision. For now, I have Rodgers in the team. But if not, this is the team for Game Week 7 as it stands. Again, there will be a deadline stream 3 hours before the deadline as always, where I will confirm my moves and my team. For now, it looks like this. Let's just have a last discussion on captaincy before we wrap up this video. So captaincy in Game Week 7 is in no way a straightforward decision. There are many captaincy shouts for Game Week 7, starting with Haaland, then Saka, Palmer, and then Salah as well. So Haaland has Fulham, Saka has Southampton, Palmer has Nottingham Forest, and Salah has Crystal Palace. So all decent enough fixtures for all these players to make it difficult to call for a Game Week 7 captaincy. Let me know down in the comments below who you are captaining. I'm very keen to see where everyone is tending to. I would say that it's between Saka and Haaland. These are the two main captaincy, you know, shouts that I'm considering for my own team as well. But it's mainly because I don't have Cole Palmer. But Cole Palmer against Nottingham Forest may be not the most ideal fixture, looking at how Nottingham Forest are defending at the moment to captain Palmer in. So I think it's mainly Saka and Haaland. Now, looking at these two options, Haaland is at 8.28 algorithm points, and Saka is at 7.58 algorithm points. So I don't think it's, you know, as close in terms of predicted points. Haaland is quite far ahead of Saka. There have been previous game weeks where it's much closer. But this week is pretty clear for Haaland. I would say that, you know, looking at it overall, I don't think it's as straightforward. But also when I kind of look at the profile of players and the way Haaland is playing right now, he is very hungry for goals. And I don't think Saka is as hungry. I think he is capable of scoring goals, but Saka doesn't come off to me as someone that just wants to score so many goals, goal after goal. He's just still hungry. He feels to me like a player that wants to do well for the team, whether it's him creating chances for them, taking set pieces for them. I still think Saka is just not that kind of a talismanic player for Arsenal. Now, I know many people are going to disagree with this, but I do think like Haaland feels more like the goal scorer, kind of an FPL asset, than Saka. So I do think because of that, I'm tending towards Haaland for now. Let me know down in the comments below where you're at. In terms of the success rate so far, it's 5 out of 6. So last week, the algorithm wanted us to captain Saka, and Saka blanked. So I think in general, it failed for 1 week already, but the past 5 weeks, it's looked pretty good. So let's see how it does for game week 7. But for myself, I think I'm on a Haaland captaincy for now. I would say it's close still, and I won't rule out the possibility that I switch it to Saka on the deadline stream. So if not, let me know where you guys are landing for captaincy as well as your own teams for game week 7. Any transfer decisions that you're making, drop it in the comments below and I'll try to help. If not, I'll see you guys as always 3 hours before the deadline on the Game Week 7 deadline stream.